Hello and welcome to the podcast. This is Ron's Amazing Stories. Last week I told you that we would have a replay this week.
No.
I don't know if you've noticed, but Ron's Amazing Stories is approaching its 300th episode.
Amazing!
In fact, it will begin this October's Month of Spooky. Anniversaries are a time to remember. So, I got to thinking, why do a Labor Day replay when we can do a I remember program? So, to start us off, here is the very first 5-minute mystery I ever played. The date was June 2nd, 2016, and it was episode 247.
Another 5-minute mystery.
Headquarters, Inspector Hoskins speaking.
Police.
Yeah? Yeah, what is it?
Sam Blake speaking, 37 Hudson Way. Come quick, my wife is dead. Gas.
Dead? How long?
I don't know. Just got home.
37 Hudson Way. Okay, be right out. And in the meantime, you better throw open those windows and doors. Hey, Mike, grab your chapeau. We got some calling to do. Mr. Blake?
Yes, Inspector. Come right in.
Thanks. Mr. Blake, my assistant, Mike Cusky.
Howdy.
Where's the body? You haven't moved her?
No, sir. She's here in the kitchen.
Oh, yeah.
Right where I found her.
Uh-huh, of course. Well, Mike and I'll just have a look.
Yeah, there she is, Inspector. Dead as a doornail.
Gassed, all right. You can still smell a little.
It looks like most of the gas came from the oven. The door's still a little open. What's that?
My simple powers of deduction would say it's a bird.
Oh, there it is, a canary. A bird cage in the kitchen, huh?
Yeah, but right now we better get back to Mr. Blake. Now, Mr. Blake, if you don't mind, there are just a few routine questions. I'd like to know exactly what happened.
Well, sir, I just come home from the game tonight. I'm quite a fan, but my wife didn't care much for sports, so I usually went alone. As I was saying, the game was over about 10:20, I should say.
And you came right home?
Yes, sir. I drove and made it home about 11. I thought I smelled something when I tried the door, and the minute it was open, it hit me in the face. Gas all over the place. I rushed in, calling to Jane, and when I went to turn off the jets, I found her there on the floor, dead.
I see.
Of course, I knew she was gone when I found her. First thing I could think of was to call the police.
Your wife has obviously been dead since about 10. Mr. Blake, if you don't mind my asking, just what happened in the last few seconds of play at the game?
Why, Zakowitz fumbled and Tarleton recovered for an 80-yard touchdown run. Look here, Inspector, what are you driving at?
Just that in case this shouldn't be suicide, I wanted to know if you could back up your alibi.
Not suicide? What are you driving at, boss?
Yes, Inspector, what are you driving at?
Just this, Mr. Blake. I arrest you for the murder of your wife.
What did Mr. Blake overlook? Do you know the clue? In a moment, we'll hear firsthand from the inspector. But first...
Hey guys, like I told you, these mysteries were sold to radio stations. This section would have been used to sell something. Pretty neat concept, and the radio stations loved them. Now, I really don't have anything to sell, so what do you say we listen to the solution?
Now, let's see if your powers of deduction are the same as the inspector's.
You can't arrest me. I was at the game till 10:20. I proved it. And you said yourself my wife died 20 minutes before.
I haven't forgotten the powers of radio, Mr. Blake. But there are a few things you did forget. First of all, if you wanted to kill your wife and then make it look like she was overcome by gas, it might have helped if you'd turned on enough gas. Your wife was dead from another cause, the source of which will be found in an autopsy before the gas jet was even opened. The thing you forgot, Mr. Blake, is that canaries are quite as susceptible to gas as human beings. If there had been enough gas in that kitchen to kill a woman, a small bird certainly could not have survived. And your singing canary is still alive, Mr. Blake. Very much alive.
I still don't have anything to sell, but you can always just send Ron's Amazing Stories money. Now, let's get back to the show. Our next bit from the past comes from very early in the show's history. I'm often asked, what is my favorite story? There are so many that I don't have an answer. But if you were to ask me, what is my favorite story from the podcast? Well, that's easy, and I'll play it for you right now. It comes from episode 38. Yes, I said episode 38, which aired on January 10th, 2012. Warning, I recorded this one before I had any decent podcasting equipment. Hello and welcome to the podcast. This is Ron's Amazing Stories, episode number 38. This week, we have a science fiction short story from the 1950s. When I search for stories each week, I try to find works that are unique and hopefully fun to listen to. I think this week I found something pretty special. The story is called Beyond Lies the Wub and was written by Philip Kendrick Dick. He was an American novelist whose published work is almost entirely in the science fiction genre. One of his best-known novels, The Man in the High Castle, bridged the genres of alternate history and science fiction, earning Dick a Hugo Award for Best Novel in 1963. Talking about his own work, he once said, "I want to write about people I love and put them into a fictional world spun out of my own mind, not the world we actually live in, because the world we actually have does not meet my standards." In addition to 44 published novels, Dick wrote approximately 121 short stories, most of which appeared in science fiction magazines. It is one of these stories that we will listen to this week. Beyond Lies the Wub is a short story by Philip K. Dick and was his first published work. It originally appeared in the science fiction magazine, Planet Stories, in July of 1952. What you will hear is a dramatic reading that once again comes to us from our friends at LibriVox.org. It is read expertly by Sean Randall, and of course, I dress it up with some music and sound effects. Please enjoy Beyond Lies the Wub.
The slovenly wub might have said, "Many men talk like philosophers and live like fools." They had almost finished with the loading. Outside stood the Optus, his arms folded, his face sunk in gloom. Captain Franco walked leisurely down the gangplank, grinning. "What's the matter?" he said. "You're getting paid for all this." The Optus said nothing. He turned away. Collecting his robes, the captain put his boot on the hem of the robe. "Just a minute, don't go off. I'm not finished."
"Oh?"
The Optus turned with dignity. "I'm going back to the village." He looked toward the animals and birds being driven up the gangplank into the spaceship. I must organize new hunts. Franco lit a cigarette. Why not? You people can go out into the veldt and track it all down again. But when we run out halfway between Mars and Earth... The Optus went off, wordless. Franco joined the first mate at the bottom of the gangplank. How's it coming? He said. He looked at his watch. We got a good bargain here. The mate glanced at him sourly. How do you explain that? What's the matter with you? We need it more than they do. I'll see you later, Captain. The mate threaded his way up the plank, between the long-legged Martian go-birds, into the ship. Franco watched him disappear. He was just starting up after him, up the plank toward the port, when he saw it. My God! He stood staring, his hands on his hips. Peterson was walking along the path, his face red, leading it by a string. I'm sorry, Captain, he said, tugging it by the string. Franco walked toward him. What is it? The wub stood sagging, its great body settling slowly. It was sitting down, its eyes half shut. A few flies buzzed about its flank, and it switched its tail. It sat. There was silence. It's a wub, Peterson said. I got it from a native for 50 cents. He said it was a very unusual animal, very respected. This? Franco poked the great sloping side of the wub. It's a pig, a huge dirty pig. Yes, sir, it's a pig. The natives call it a wub. A huge pig. It must weigh 400 pounds. Franco grabbed a tuft of the rough hair. The wub gasped. Its eyes opened, small and moist, then its great mouth twitched. A tear rolled down the wub's cheek and splashed on the floor. Maybe it's good to eat, Peterson said nervously. We'll soon find out, Franco said. The wub survived the takeoff, sound asleep in the hold of the ship. When they were out in space and everything was running smoothly, Captain Franco bade his men fetch the wub upstairs so that he might perceive what manner of beast it was. The wub grunted and wheezed, squeezing up the passageway. Come on, Jones grated, pulling at the rope. The wub twisted, rubbing its skin off on the smooth chrome walls. It burst into the anteroom, tumbling down in a heap. The men leaped up. Good Lord, French said. What is it? Peterson says it's a wub, Jones says. It belongs to him. He kicked at the wub. The wub stood up unsteadily, panting. What's the matter with it? French came over. Is it going to be sick? They watched. The wub rolled its eyes mournfully. It gazed around at the men. I think it's thirsty, Peterson said. He went to get some water. French shook his head. No wonder we had so much trouble taking off. I had to reset all my ballast calculations. Peterson came back with the water. The wub began to lap gratefully, splashing the men. Captain Franco appeared at the door. Let's have a look at it. He advanced, squinting critically. You got this for 50 cents? Yes, sir, Peterson said. It eats almost anything. I fed it on grain, and it liked that, and then potatoes, and mash, and scraps from the table, and milk. It seems to enjoy eating. After it eats, it lies down and goes to sleep. I see, Captain Franco said. Now, as to its taste, that's the real question. I doubt if there's much point in fattening it up any more. It seems fat enough to me already. Where's the cook? I want him here. I want to find out... The wub stopped lapping and looked up at the captain. Really, Captain, the wub said. I suggest we talk of other matters. The room was silent. What was that? Franco said. Just now. The wub, sir, Peterson said. It spoke. They all looked at the wub. What did it say? What did it say? It suggested we talk about other things. Franco walked toward the wub. He went all around it, examining it from every side. Then he came back over and stood with the men. I wonder if there's a native inside of it, he said thoughtfully. Maybe we should open it up and have a look. Oh, goodness, the wub cried. Is that all you people can think of? Killing and cutting? Franco clenched his fists. Come out of there! Whoever you are, come out! Nothing stirred. The men stood together, their faces blank, staring at the wub. The wub swished its tail. It belched suddenly. I beg your pardon, the wub said. I don't think there's anyone in there, Jones said in a low voice. They all looked at each other. The cook came in. You wanted me, Captain? He said. What's this thing? This is a wub, Franco said. It's to be eaten. Will you measure it and figure out? I think we should have a talk, the wub said. I'd like to discuss this with you, Captain, if I might. I can see that you and I do not agree on some basic issues. The captain took a long time to answer. The wub waited good-naturedly, licking the water from its jowls. Come into my office, the captain said at last. He turned and walked out of the room. The wub rose and padded after him. The men watched it go out and heard it climbing the stairs. I wonder what the outcome will be, the cook said. Well, I'll be in the kitchen. Let me know as soon as you hear. Sure, Jones said. Sure. The wub eased itself down in the corner with a sigh. You must forgive me, it said. I'm afraid I'm addicted to various forms of relaxation. When one is as large as I... The captain nodded impatiently. He sat down at his desk and folded his hands. All right, he said. Let's get started. You're a wub, is that correct? The wub shrugged. I suppose so. That's what they call us, the natives. I mean, we have our own term. And you speak English? You've been in contact with Earthmen before. No. Then how do you do it? Speak English? Am I speaking English? I'm not conscious of speaking anything in particular. I examined your mind.
My mind?
I studied the contents, especially the semantic warehouse, as I refer to it.
I see, the captain said.
Telepathy, of course. We are a very old race, the wub said. Very old and very ponderous. It is difficult for us to move around. You can appreciate that anything so slow and heavy would be at the mercy of more agile forms of life. There was no use in our relying on physical defences. How could we win? Too heavy to run? Too soft to fight? Too good-natured to hunt for game?
How do you live?
Plants, vegetables. We can eat almost anything. We're very Catholic. Tolerant, eclectic, Catholic. We live and let live. That's how we've gotten along.
The wub eyed the captain.
And that's why I so violently objected to this business about having me boiled. I could see the image in your mind of me in the frozen food locker, some of me in the kettle, and a bit for your pet cat.
So you read minds, the captain said.
How interesting.
Anything else?
I mean, what else can you do along those lines? A few odds and ends, the wub said, absently, staring around the room. A nice apartment you have here, Captain. You keep it quite neat. I respect life forms that are tidy. Some Martian birds are quite tidy. They throw things out of their nests and sweep them.
Indeed, the captain nodded.
But to get back to the problem. Quite so. You spoke of dining on me. The taste, I am told, is good. A little fatty, but tender. But how can any lasting contact be established between your people and mine if you resort to such barbaric attitudes? Eat me? Rather, you should discuss questions with me. Philosophy, the arts.
The captain stood up.
Philosophy? It might interest you to know that we'll be hard put to find something to eat for the next month. An unfortunate spoilage.
I know,
the wub nodded. But wouldn't it be more in accord with your principles of democracy if we all drew straws or something along that line? After all, democracy is to protect the minority from just such infringements.
Now, if each of us casts one vote... The captain walked to the door. "That's to you," he said. He opened the door. He opened his mouth. He stood, frozen, his mouth wide, his eyes staring, his fingers still on the knob. The wub watched him. Presently it padded out of the room, edging past the captain. It went down the hall, deep in meditation. The room was quiet. "So, you see," the wub said, "we have a common myth. Your mind contains many familiar myth symbols. Ishtar, Odysseus." Peterson sat silently, staring at the floor. He shifted in his chair. "Go on," he said. "Please, go on." "I find in your Odysseus a figure common to the mythology of most self-conscious races. As I interpret it, Odysseus wanders as an individual, aware of himself as such. This is the idea of separation from family and country, the process of individuation. But Odysseus returns to his home." Peterson looked out the port window at the stars, endless stars, burning intently in the empty universe. "Finally, he goes home. As must all creatures. The moment of separation is a temporary period, a brief journey of the soul. It begins, it ends. The wanderer returns to land and race." The door opened. The wub stopped, turning its great head. Captain Franco came into the room, the men behind him. They hesitated at the door. "Are you all right?" French said. "Do you mean me?" Peterson said, surprised. "Why me?" Franco lowered his gun. "Come over here," he said to Peterson. "Get up and come here." There was silence. "Go ahead," the wub said. "It doesn't matter." Peterson stood up. "What for?" "It's an order." Peterson walked to the door. French caught his arm. "What's going on?" Peterson wrenched loose. "What's the matter with you?" Captain Franco moved toward the wub. The wub looked up from where it lay, in the corner, pressed against the wall. "It is interesting," the wub said, "that you are obsessed with the idea of eating me. I wonder why." "Get up," Franco said. "If you wish," the wub rose, grunting. "Be patient. It is difficult for me." It stood, gasping, its tongue lolling foolishly. "Shoot it now," French said. "For God's sake," Peterson exclaimed. Jones turned to him quickly, his eyes grey with fear. "You didn't see him like a statue, standing there, his mouth open. If we hadn't come down, he'd still be there." "Who? The captain?" Peterson stared around. "But he's all right now." They looked at the wub standing in the middle of the room, its great chest rising and falling. "Come on," Franco said. "Out of the way." The men pulled aside toward the door. "You are quite afraid, aren't you?" the wub said. "Have I done anything to you? I am against the idea of hurting. All I have done is try to protect myself. Can you expect me to rush eagerly to my death? I am a sensible being like yourselves. I was curious to see your ship, learn about you. I suggested to the native..." The gun jerked. "See?" Franco said. "I thought so." The wub settled down, panting. It put its paw out, pulling its tail around it. "It is very warm," the wub said. "I understand that we are close to the jets. Atomic power. You have done many wonderful things with it, technically. Apparently your scientific hierarchy is not equipped to solve moral, ethical..." Franco turned to the men crowding behind him, wide-eyed, silent. "I'll do it. You can watch." French nodded. "Try to hit the brain. It's no good for eating. Don't hit the chest. If the ribcage shatters, we'll have to pick bones out." "Listen," Peterson said, licking his lips. "Has it done anything? What harm has it done? I'm asking you. And anyhow, it's still mine. You have no right to shoot it. It doesn't belong to you."
Franco raised his gun. "I'm going out," Jones said, his face white and sick. "I don't want to see it."
"Me too," French said.
The men straggled out, murmuring. Peterson lingered at the door.
"It was talking to me about myths," he said. "It wouldn't hurt anyone."
He went outside. Franco walked toward the wub. The wub looked up slowly. It swallowed.
"A very foolish thing," it said. "I'm sorry that you want to do it. There was a parable that your saviour related..."
It stopped, staring at the gun.
"Can you look me in the eye and do it?" the wub said. "Can you do that?"
The captain gazed down. "I can look you in the eye," he said. "Back on the farm, we had hogs, dirty razorback hogs. I can do it." Staring down at the wub into the gleaming, moist eyes, he pressed the trigger. The taste was excellent. They sat glumly around the table, some of them hardly eating at all. The only one who seemed to be enjoying himself was Captain Franco.
"More," he said, looking around. "More? And some more wine, perhaps?" "Not me," French said. "I think I'll go back to the chart room."
"Me too." Jones stood up, pushing his chair back. "I'll see you later." The captain watched them go. Some of the others excused themselves.
"What do you suppose the matter is?" the captain said. He turned to Peterson.
Peterson sat staring down at his plate, at the potatoes, the green peas, and at the thick slab of tender, warm meat. He opened his mouth. No sound came. The captain put his hand on Peterson's shoulder.
"It is only organic matter now," he said. "The life essence is gone."
He ate, spooning up the gravy with some bread.
"I myself love to eat. It is one of the greatest things that a living creature can enjoy. Eating, resting, meditation, discussing things."
Peterson nodded. Two more men got up and went out. The captain drank some water and sighed.
"Well," he said, "I must say that this was a very enjoyable meal. All the reports I'd heard were quite true. The taste of wub, very fine. But I was prevented from enjoying this pleasure in times past."
He dabbed at his lips with a napkin and leaned back in his chair. Peterson stared dejectedly at the table. The captain watched him intently. He leaned over.
"Come, come," he said. "Cheer up. Let's discuss things."
He smiled.
"As I was saying before I was interrupted, the role of Odysseus in the myths..."
Peterson jerked up, staring.
"To go on," the captain said. "Odysseus, as I understand him..."
So I'm left to wonder who exactly got shot. That one leaves us a lot to think about. Our story this week first appeared in written form in the magazine Planet Stories. Planet Stories was an American pulp science fiction magazine published by Fiction House between 1939 and 1955. It featured interplanetary adventures both in space and on other planets. Initially, its content focused on a younger readership, but expanded after interest in science fiction grew in the late 1940s. The first issue was launched at the same time as Planet Comics, the success of which probably helped fund the early issues of the magazine. Planet Stories did not pay well, but did manage to obtain work from well-known names on occasion. These included Isaac Asimov, and of course the author of our story today, Philip K. Dick. Favorite interview, you ask? Well, sure thing. It was Brian Grant. Now, I love a good story, and his is nothing short of amazing. Please enjoy episode number 49 from March 27th, 2012. Now, for this one, I'm going to play the entire podcast, including the closing. Please note that some of the info presented by Brian is dated. However, all of the links he presents work today, even 5 years later. Welcome to the podcast. This is Ron's Amazing Stories. I'm very excited about our guest today. Brian Grant played 12 years in the NBA as a power forward and was the heart and soul of the Sacramento Kings, Portland Trailblazers, Miami Heat, Los Angeles Lakers, and Phoenix Suns. His career spanned from 1994 to 2006. In 2008, Brian was diagnosed with young-onset Parkinson's disease, and today he serves as both advocate and an inspiration to those suffering with Parkinson's. His foundation has many projects and stands as a beacon promoting hope to those afflicted. Welcome to the podcast, Brian.
Thanks for having me on, Ron. Appreciate it.
First off, let me say I've been a big fan of yours for a very long time. During the years you were a Portland Trailblazer, I had season tickets. One of the things I loved to watch was you and Arvydas Sabonis. His passes led to some massive dunks.
I tell you what, that was a tricky thing, being on the floor with an amazing passer like Arvydas. You know, if you caught the ball, he would continue to feed the ball to you. But if you dropped it, you got the and then you knew that it was going to take a while before he, you know, built some confidence up. But after the first year, I think he pretty much knew if he put it anywhere near me, I was going to catch it and hopefully finish it. So, yeah, I really enjoyed playing with him. It was easy buckets with him.
Yeah. Well, so what I guess I'd like to do is to start this off correctly is I'd like to hear a little bit about your years in Columbus, Ohio, and where you grew up. And can you talk a little bit about that for us?
Well, I was actually born in Columbus, Ohio, but I grew up in a small town outside of Cincinnati with the borough. When I was growing up there, maybe 2,000 people.
Oh, wow.
1,800. And it was a farming community. Did a lot of cutting tobacco and baling hay and digging potatoes. A lot of farm work. I didn't own a farm. Didn't live on a farm, but there were a lot of farms, so I did a lot of farm work. And it was good. A good little small Midwest town.
Were you interested in basketball in those years, or did that come along later?
It came along later. You know, I grew up around roughly 11 cousins that were either a year older or same age or a year younger, so it was almost like growing up in a family of 12 kids, because we were always together staying at our grandma and grandpa's house. And there was only one girl and the rest of us were boys, and they all seemed to be into Syracuse, Georgetown, Hoyas. I had no interest. My mother finally took my younger brother and I, and signed us up for Pop Warner football. And that's, you know, I just love football. I love the contact. I love the excitement of trying to, you know, run that ball down the field with people trying to catch you. And then I also love, you know, being able to hit somebody on defense. And it wasn't until I reached high school that I went out for a team basketball-wise. I made the freshman team, and then it wasn't until my senior year that I would play again.
So you decided to go to Xavier University. I'm assuming that was just close by, or is there another reason you wanted to go to Xavier?
Well, Xavier was close by. It was only maybe 10 minutes away from where I grew up, so I was close to home. And they were the first major Division I school to offer me a full scholarship. And, you know, I was the first person in my town to ever receive, the second person, a girl by the name of Kelly Benintendi. She ended up getting a full ride to Michigan, and she was probably 6 or 7 years older than me. So I was the first person in my family, you know, through any generation, to receive a full ride to school. And the reason why I chose Xavier, they had a great year that year before, where they had Tyrone Hill and Derek Strong, and they beat Alonzo Mourning and Dikembe Mutombo,
yes,
in the second round to go to the Sweet 16. And then B, because they were the first ones to offer me the scholarship, and I just immediately jumped on it.
Well, and you responded very well. I mean, you led the team in rebounding all for every year you were there, and you were, weren't you a two-time conference player of the year?
Yes, two-time.
That's incredible. So you were drafted, and you went very high in the first round to the NBA. What was that like when they actually said, "Hey, we want you on the Sacramento Kings"? I've heard a lot of NBA players talk about it, but to me, it would just be almost surreal.
Well, I didn't really believe it when I didn't believe all the talk that was going on before the draft, because after my senior year, I interviewed four agents. Three agents told me that if I went to the Desert Classic in Phoenix, that I wouldn't be drafted right now. I'm possibly a second-round draft pick and definitely a European player. And there was only one agent that really, truly believed in me, and that was Mark Bartelstein from Priority Sports. And he just told me if I didn't go, it would be the biggest injustice I've ever done myself. You know, so I went with him because he believed in me. And when I got there, it was the same thing. Nobody knew me. No letters to go visit any teams. But after that first game that we had skills in the morning. I'm not a skilled player. You know, people just kind of overlook me. And then that evening, I had Casey Jones from the Boston Celtics coaching our team. And I went to Khalid Reeves and Anthony Goldwire, and I just told him, I said, look, if I get if I get the rebound and I beat everyone down the floor, will you throw it to me? And I'll dunk it and give you the assist. They say, if you beat everybody down the floor, we'll throw it to you. And that's what I did. And I ended up with like 24 wow. points and 20 rebounds. And then from that, I went from a nobody to everybody wanted to see what was up. Huh. And it was just, it was a crazy ride, man. You know, it was a really crazy ride. And then even when my agent said he was getting me an airline ticket to the draft, I told him no. I said, really? I don't want to get embarrassed. He said, you're going to be a top 10 pick. And I said, I don't believe it. I'm staying in Cincinnati. And I did. I stayed in Cincinnati with family and friends and watched the draft.
Oh, you weren't even there that night?
No.
Wow. That's incredible. So how was that? Did your family go nuts? Or?
Yeah, I mean, I come from a very poor family.
Mm-hmm.
And just, not a lot of hopes and dreams for African Americans, especially in that region. And to, first of all, go to college there, my grandparents, everyone was so proud of me.
Yeah.
My town was proud of me. But then just the thought that he might make it to the NBA, and then all of a sudden, bam, he's a lottery pick.
Wow.
And I think it blew everybody away. I mean, it put our little town on the map. People were very proud to be from Georgetown, Ohio, and just the same as I am.
Well, after you were drafted, you spent a few years with the Sacramento Kings, and you opted out of your contract early, right?
I did, yeah.
And you went free agency and were courted by the Portland Trailblazers. And I've always wanted to ask you, of all the teams in the leagues that were going after you, why Portland?
Well, there weren't really a ton of teams going after me. I mean, there were maybe like three.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, three. And then there were other teams that were talking, but three seriously were going after me. And I didn't like Portland as a city at that point, because uh-huh. every time I flew in, it was always raining and dreary and miserable, and I couldn't wait to get out. But I did like that team, and I knew that the atmosphere in Portland was similar to what I would be leaving in Sacramento, because those fans in Sacramento are great. They're awesome fans.
They're yes, true, they are.
Just like the Portland Trailblazer fans are. And so I knew I'd be getting that. Not only that, they had Arvydas Sabonis. They
yeah.
had Rasheed Wallace. They had, J.R. Ryder. They were an up-and-coming team. They were already up. It was just, but they were just putting together some pieces to make a run for it, and I figured that I could work my way in there somewhere. I didn't know how it fit along Rasheed Wallace until I got there and realized that he was such a great shooter that he could play the three at his height. So I played the four and he played the three.
Yeah, and you started for two of the years that you were there, right?
I did, and then I had a microfracture surgery and after my second year, and I was kind of a little late getting back. And then, our team was so stacked with talent that coach started off with the lineup, and I thought that I would get that starting position back, but I'm also a team player. I realized that what he had going was working, and me coming off the bench with the secondary made us even more of a threat as a team. So,
mm-hmm. So I can't let the Portland Trail Blazers years go by without talking about the conference finals in 2000.
Yeah.
What was that night like when you guys, you'd gone seven games with the Lakers? I was watching that game. I thought, this is in the bag. We're going to the finals. And what was it like on your side? How did you guys feel?
It was surreal. It just seemed like a dream. It just, we were all like deer caught in the headlights.
Really?
You know, just talking about it just took my mood down, because you couldn't imagine how confident we were going into that locker room at halftime. You know, sitting there just making plans. Okay, we're going to Indiana. Oh, I know we can do Indiana. I know we can do them. And then that second half through the third quarter, still up and just kicking, and all the way, you know, a little, almost halfway through the fourth quarter. And then all of a sudden, I think Robert Horry banked in a three.
Yeah.
No, Brian Shaw actually hit a shot. And I remember Brian Shaw hit that shot, and I remember telling myself, man, we released him. And I remember the day we released him off the roster, and he called me and said, look, you guys got an opportunity to win, B. Go for it. You don't get these opportunities that often. And then he signs with L.A. Mm-hmm. And then he's the first one that hits that shot. So the guy that we did not put on the roster starts that run against us. And I remember thinking, that, like, a cold chill went down my back, like, uh-oh, that's not right. And then all of a sudden, three here, and we couldn't hit a shot. We couldn't. It did not matter what we did. We couldn't hit a shot. We're missing free throws. It just all came apart so quickly that, you know, we were just like caught in the fog. And in the locker room, just looking around the atmosphere, I knew that was it for me. I knew that this was like a win that an organization really doesn't recover from for years, you know.
And they didn't.
Yeah.
So moving on. So you played quite a few more years in the NBA up until, I believe, about 2006. Is that right?
Correct. Yeah. Phoenix was my last team.
Phoenix. I read through some of your background, and you kind of said then that you felt like your skills were leaving you then. Is that?
Yeah, I did. I mean, and it was weird. I just assumed, because my knees were hurting, and I had my right knee going arthritic, you know, that one was a no-brainer. I understood that. But there were other things, like, you know, I was pretty good at going in and making left-hand layups, and, you know, just feeling like I could spring off the ground even with a bad knee. And that all started going away, and I just attributed it to, you know, I'm getting old. But I was only 35, 36, and still had a lot of play in me. But other than the knee, I sensed something wasn't right. But this is what happens to players. That's what I wrote it off as.
Hmm. So then things went on for your life. You went into retirement, and then in 2008 you were diagnosed. And so, what brought that about? Was it just a normal physical, or was it?
No, it was after I retired and I moved back to Miami. I went through a really bad bout of depression. It lasted for like 8 months, and it was the kind of depression where you stay on the couch eating Captain Crunch, watching the Hunting Channel all day, and that was how bad it was for me. I mean, I had a boat, there was beautiful weather, a lot of fishing, a lot of friends, but I couldn't do anything. And so finally, after my wife going through the hell that she went through with my depression, encouraged me to go and seek help. And I did, and I found out that I was deeply depressed. We just attributed it to me retiring. But at the same time, I started to notice that I had a little shake in my hand, like it would twitch every once in a while. And so I went to a neurologist, and he was more concerned with the depression and didn't want to scare me by telling me Parkinson's or anything else. He just said, let's just deal with the depression and see where we are after that. And so I stayed in Miami for a year and a half, and then I just decided, you know what, I want to get out of Miami. I want to get my family back to Portland. Maybe a change of scenery will help, you know, calm me down. And even though it's dreary and rainy out here in Portland, you know, I have some really good friends, and there's, you know, great people out here. Not that there's none in Miami, but I just know more people out here.
Yeah.
And so I moved the family back, and it just continued to get worse and worse. And I knew that I needed to figure out what it was, because I was starting to turn down opportunities to go and try out for anchor jobs and radio positions. I was literally pissing people off, because they thought, well, you know, here we are offering you an opportunity to come in and try out, and you won't come try out. But I couldn't tell them why, because I didn't know what was going on with me, but I was just embarrassed by this tremor in my head. So it wasn't until 2008 that I went in and saw Dr. Nutt up at OHSU, and he examined me for probably about 20 minutes, and he just looked me in the eye and said, look, I'm prepared to tell you that I believe you have young onset Parkinson's. And it was a blow to the head, you know. It was just like, wow, here I am. You know, I'm having marital problems. I'm having physical problems. I just retired from a game that I've been playing all my life. And, you know, now I just found out that, you know, I have Parkinson's. But, you know, like with everything, man, you got to take these hits in life, and then you got to figure out a way to pick yourself up and get through it. And that's what I eventually did. Mm.
So from there, you started the foundation right after that. Is that correct?
I did. I started the foundation 2 months after I was diagnosed. I received a phone call from Michael J. Fox, and it was, you know, Michael J. Fox is the ultimate person in staying optimistic, and he's a very optimistic individual. He's uplifting, and, you know, I just had a conversation with him that empowered me to get up and join the fight against Parkinson's, and that's when I contacted Lauren Foreman, who ran my children's foundation, and asked her if she'd be willing to throw an event to raise as much money as we can for the Michael J. Fox Foundation. And that's how we started off. We didn't start off with a foundation. We didn't want to do a foundation. But as we were kind of piecing this event together and starting to meet more and more Parkinson's patients, I realized that, you know, there are a lot of people going through the same issues that I'm going through, and there's really no one thing to help them out when they're newly diagnosed. And I'm not talking about programming after you're diagnosed and things you can do. I'm just talking about a site that you can go to and after you've received this terrible news and then find out that you're not alone. It's not a death sentence. And this disease does not have to be who you are. You can still be who you are. You just live with the disease. You know, we raised $350,000 for the Michael J. Fox Foundation.
Yeah.
You know, we started off with no money, and then we just, you know, because we gave it all to Michael J. Fox, then we organized and started the Brian Grant Foundation.
Yeah. Well, and one of the things that I was reading about and I was just very impressed with was the use of Powering Forward. What a great name to begin with, but can you talk a little bit about that? And I know you have somewhat, but How did that come about? Is that just something that you came up with in the foundation, or is it?
Well, honestly, it started because we were trying to figure out a name for the event. Mm. And I figured, you know, why not Powering Forward? Because I'm a power forward. And,
yeah, exactly.
And it empowers people to, you know, move forward through this disease. And then we came up with Shake It Till We Make It. And then we were kind of on the fence with that because we didn't want to offend anybody. But then the more I thought about it, you know, Powering Forward is good, but you know what? People need to have a little sense of humor with this thing too, because it can't be all long faces and dreariness. You got to be able to laugh at this thing too. So we came up with Shake It Till We Make It. And then once we started developing the website, we were calling it Powering Forward in the beginning, but we've since changed that. And Powering Forward would just be a slogan that we use, and also to highlight kind of my own personal journey through my walk in Parkinson's, that people will be able to see on the website. After we started the foundation, you know, our mission is simple. It's to empower unique and fulfilling lives for people living with Parkinson's disease. And our vision is to be the first place that people go to when they're first diagnosed. Like me, I couldn't find any place that encouraged me. It was all medical terms. It was all programming that I had absolutely no clue what it meant for me. I just wanted to know that I wasn't alone and things like that. And so people can, when they're diagnosed, or if they have friends or family that are diagnosed, so people can visit briangrant.org, where there's an online community, active online community of Parkinson's patients as well as caregivers that communicate on our online forum. And then there's also video testimonies of people ranging from different ages that talk about when they were diagnosed and how they felt and their concerns. And we've had several people who have visited the site who were newly diagnosed just tell us, you know what, thank you for that. And I wish I had that when I was diagnosed, but I did have Michael J. Fox call me, which was amazing as well.
Yeah, I bet that was shocking.
Yeah. So, you know, and then as far as our programming at the Brian Graham Foundation, exercise and fitness that benefits Parkinson's patients is our main focus right now.
Mm-hmm.
Because we see that there's a great benefit in exercise and healthy eating and living. And then from there, we're going to go into relationships and managing health care to help people manage their health care.
Mm-hmm. On that line, when you say manage their health care, is that to manage it financially or just how to manage?
Well, just managing problems that may arise, like with, you know, your employer.
Oh, I see.
Managing your relationship with your neurologist.
Mm-hmm. That's incredible. I mean, that seems like... That would take a lot of work to help people to do those things.
Well, the thing that we do is we recognize other great organizations out there.
Mm-hmm.
Namely, a really good one is right here in our own backyard. It's called Parkinson's Resources of Oregon, and they are great. And they've already got tons of programming. And we would be more or less a pass-through organization.
I see.
That would send people to, look, this is what you're looking to do. The best information for that is right here, and this is what they do. This is their programming that they have going on. And if it's something that we do, we would highlight that. But we already know that we're not trying to reinvent the wheel. I get tongue-tied too, Ron.
Well, you know, normally I don't, but sometimes it just gets me. Well, Brian, can you take a few minutes and go over the website names again so we make sure people know how to find you?
Yeah. If you want to contact the Brian Grant Foundation, go to briangrant.org. There's ways to contact us and telephone numbers. Also, you can look at some of our fundraising things that we do, mainly our Shake It Till We Make It event, which will be this July 15th and 16th, which will be star-studded with people such as Charles Barkley, who we've been blessed to have 2 years in a row. Hopefully he'll make it out a third year, but there will be people out there, and it's always an exciting evening. And followed by the next day on the 16th with our golf tournament at Pumpkin Ridge. Last year we had both courses going, Witch and Ghost, and it was just a really fun day.
Yeah.
So if you want information on purchasing tables or foursomes, you can also find that information on briangrant.org.
Great. Well, I want to thank you for being on the show, Brian. It has been a pleasure.
Thanks, Ron. I appreciate it. Thank you for having me on.
What an inspirational story. I hope you enjoyed listening as much as I did doing that interview. For whatever reason, I was nervous, and it showed up right at the first. I must have babbled for 10 to 15 seconds before I even let Brian get a word in. However, through the miracle of editing, I fixed that. I felt a bit bad about that, though, and thought I might play a bit of what I cut. Consider this a blooper from Ron's Amazing Stories. Welcome to the podcast, Brian.
Thanks for having me on, Ron. Appreciate it.
I got to say, during the years that you were with the Portland Trailblazers, I was a season ticket holder, and I was fairly high up, but I loved watching you play. One of the things that I absolutely remember the most is you and Arvidas. I don't know if maybe it's, vision looking back 2020, or if it's just that year was incredible in 2000 anyway, but looking back, it was just an amazing thing. And one of the things I do remember is Arvidas passing you the ball and you going up for the those good dunks. Wow. All I can say is my mind went absolutely numb. I'm not sure what I was even trying to say. Vision looking back is 2020. Holy mackerel. I wonder what Brian thought. I'll have to ask him one day.
What's that you say?
Well, today on Listener's Email, I have a special treat. My niece wanted to take part in the podcast, so as part of her 12th birthday present, I told her to write a story and I would put it on the podcast. Well, she did, and then we sat down together to produce it. What you will hear next is the outcome. Happy birthday, Sarah.
Just story you are about to hear is dedicated to my grandpa who passed away a few years ago. One of the things I loved about him was that he would always tell me chicken stories. These stories were always pointless, but I would love them anyway. My mother has taken over the role of head chicken storyteller, so they continue on. I wanted to share one with you that I made up to honor my grandpa. What you're about to hear is going to be crazy.
Roasters and chickens, I am Kung Pao. Today we are here to crown the next heavyweight Southwest KFC champion. In this corner, weighing at 10 pounds 2 ounces, is the Coyote Slayer, the Coop Casanova, Muhammad Chickley. And in this corner, at the lean 9 pounds 5 ounces, is New Egg on the Skillet, the rookie who took down Mick Tyson in 2 rounds, Evander Barnyard. Let's get ready to scramble! Let's hand it over to Sir Frederick Chickendale to get a few crowd reactions.
Thank you, Kung Pao. You, lady, who are you rooting for?
Mohammed, like, duh, have you seen his wings? He's like the winner for show.
Back to you, Kung Pao.
This is Rhode Island Red, and I will be calling the action. And there goes the bell. Man, this is going to be a good fight. Right out of the gate, Chick Lee takes a hard flap to the beak. Many more like that, and this fight's over. Evander seems ready to go on the attack. But wait! No, you're not going to believe what I see. Chick Lee does a flip. Chick Lee does a flip behind Evander, does the hay bell, and sent Evander into the ropes. That could be it, folks. The rookie looks stunned. No, he's going to get up. He's trying to get up. He's up. He's heading for the corner. But no, Chick Lee is on him. Here a flap, there a flap, everywhere a flap, flap. Barnyard goes down. It's over. It's over. The rookie taps out. Look at that. The champ is raising his wings in victory, and the chickens are going wild.
Thanks, Grandpa. I miss you and the stories you told. Thank you to my mom for continuing the crazy legacy. Chickens are fun, but family creates memories.
Well, of course, the grandpa that she spoke of was my dad. I grew up listening to his chicken stories myself, and I know it was those tales that prompted my love for stories and storytelling.
I hope you liked this little blast into the past. For me, it was easy to put together, but not as easy as playing a replay. If you like this show, tell me by going to Ron's Amazing Stories, the Facebook page, and clicking on like, love, or any other button that will tell me how you feel. Now, I hope to hear your feedback, so just take a minute and do it. We'll be back next week with all new stories, so see you next week.